The Bala Wande team worked with the Marco D team, and we have developed a Sepedi version of the instrument. The instrument is an incredible systemic test which can be used diagnostically. And I think that's something quite special. People have spoken about how much we assess and what the purpose of that assessment is. And I think an instrument that can be used at a higher level, but to be useful to teachers in the classroom, is one that hasn't really been seen in other instances. So just to put that on the program, and to apologize for Aurelien's absence, and to hope that there'll be another opportunity where we can share that work with you. Anil, over to you.
Afternoon, everybody. Firstly, again, just thank Ingrid for inviting me, and like many speakers, like, why are you inviting me to a numeracy conference, especially since I'm a qualified computer science teacher who failed at maths, or failed to teach maths. Like, so I failed as a high school maths teacher. It was the only job I could get, and other stuff. Having said that, I also appreciate the opportunity, and I say, okay, let's see, this is an engagement. It's a critical engagement to share experiences and expertise, and on a really critical issue that I think we need to address. And I'm going to argue that the opportunity provided now by COVID is unique, and we're not going to get it again. And if we don't use it, we're the only ones to blame. I think a lot of the speakers up front had said really critical issues, and so my presentation is going to be a techno-practical thingy type of presentation. That's how. So I'm going to look at the understanding of diagnostic assessment, options for applications, reporting, dissemination, and impact. You guys have that machine? Okay, so let me quickly then just go over this. I'll come back to the slide. So here's the thing. If you're tired, feel free to take a nap. I'm going to summarize what I'm going to do. Go for the nap. Okay. So essentially, I'm going to provide a definition, understanding. I'm going to illustrate how it fits in the diagnostic assessment, fits in the teaching learning process. I'll give a few examples on our work. And I have to say our work because I've looked at other work, but I haven't studied it enough detail to critique it. Time permitting, I'll introduce some of the different stuff. Time permitting, the Excel sheet we did, and somebody showed a really nice Excel sheet, and then I do think it's important to talk on the impact of COVID-19 and its implications, and several speakers spoke about it. Now, there's one request, though. So, if you are going to take a nap, please. The request is that, please don't snore. It really irritates me, okay? So, feel free to check your emails, etc. So, here's the context. Issue of assessment is an ongoing challenge, not only in South Africa. I just got back from Mexico last night, swearing SAA throughout the entire journey because it took me 3 days to go. If SAA was functioning, I would have been there in a day and a half. COVID has highlighted impact and value all over the world, all institutions. Here's the challenge that is ongoing from all experts. There's different understandings. There's lack of consensus, there's confusion on its meaning, application, interpretation, etc. So and one thing that we've done recently in South Africa in particular, that we have made significant changes which I in my lifetime didn't think we would have achieved. And it has a huge potential for both quality and equity. And we've been arguing diagnostic assessment is a key strategy that the DBE has been using as one of them. And the last point I didn't put there, but no. Since 96, South Africa has undertaken 112 large-scale assessment studies, if we include the Western Cape stuff. A rough estimate, between friends, 5 to 10 billion we spent on it. But again, what's a few billion among friends, right? Having said that, the value of that was very, very minimal. So I think I completely agree with Kim about the people in the Silicon Valley who's trying to control our lives and using COVID as a basis. I think this issue is really important, but I'm not going to talk about it. But I have to say that it underpins a lot of our work and I don't have much time to talk about it. So yeah, what's the understanding of diagnostic assessment? First, I do think we need a very clear theory of change, which basically argues, I'm going to skip over this, that if you provide meaningful, useful information to key users, and I'm including teachers, learners, parents, etc., they would use it, and it would enhance and improve decision-making. And so the responsibility lies on us to do that. So what is diagnostic assessment? Okay. So it's a very easy definition. It's assessment aimed at identifying current levels of knowledge, understanding, skills with a view of taking necessary action. And recently we wrote a paper, with Nikki, and we coined a new term, assessment AWT. You know what it stands for? You know what is AOL, right? What? Assessment of Learning, AFL, and AWT, Assessment for Wasting Time. And there's a whole lot of assessment to show I'm busy, assessment to make my HOD happy, assessment to make the minister happy, etc., etc. We're not talking of that type yet. And so the point here is to take necessary action. And that's quite critical. So here's the key, at least my interpretation and the reading and the general consensus in the literature and current changes from the psychometric tradition and behaviorist tradition that diagnostic assessment emerged to the current socio-cultural and cognitive approaches that it is currently being applied, is that we need information on how a task is solved as indicative of the development stage of the learner. Does that make sense? How a task is solved that indicate where is this child of mine so I can help him. The defining characteristics and implications is that one, a focus has to be on individual learners because I'm having every child. And the approach Jeanette, I and our work is we advocate for our teachers. I see you, my child. I care about you. I will give you a chance to participate in the lesson and I'm going to help you. That underlying approach, if you want to call it, is critical here. Teacher-led process, etc., standardized, easy to use by teachers. The point Kim made is vital. We don't need assessments where we must do analysis for our teachers. They're smart enough, they're committed enough, they're strong enough, they can use it. We need to help them to make them use it better. And that's the point. And it provides an indication of effective feedback. And this is very serious. Effective feedback is not pull up your socks. Effective feedback is not stop this nonsense. Right? And definitely it's not you again. Effective feedback is when we help a child take action that he or she can take on her own to improve what he or she doesn't know. That's really important, and that's a whole new paper, and my colleague Jeanette here can talk about it. So, the critical requirement and underline for all of us, we cannot use diagnostic assessments, I'm going to argue, if in our own lives we don't have a data-driven culture ourselves. So if we budget to say yes, today I feel like buying that new Merc, let's somehow buy it. If you function in that environment and you say, no, you're not looking at your bank balance and your salaries, etc., and you don't use data for decision, you're not going to be able to use diagnostic assessment. And that goes right through the system. And I'm arguing that data culture has to be inculcated for it to work with teachers. Ministry officials, first and foremost, at all levels need to know what diagnostic assessment and must use it for their own work before they can come tell me as a teacher, this is what I should use. And our teachers are smart. They know when you're talking nonsense. So, quick question. Which item would you select for a diagnostic assessment test? One, two, and three, and easy. One, two, or three? One, two, or three? I'll give you a minute. They're all the same questions, the distractors are separate. All written with high quality item writing principles, etc. Which item would you select? Right, come. You got a minute over. If you didn't finish, hard luck. One, two, or three? Don't? Okay. Did I ask you to shout? Yeah. One, two, or three? Simple. Okay, guys. In my culture, there's no shouting this. This is like, well, one. This is not what I'm asking you to. One, two, or three. By the way, it's a formative assessment technique that we allow every child in the class an opportunity to engage. Not only those with loud voices who shout. It doesn't make sense. Okay, show me indication. Okay, good. Can I ask somebody to volunteer why you're choosing that? Somebody, anyone. No, not Nikki, I know her. Who else? Yes, go ahead.
Because I like just option two.
Yeah.
Because each one of those answers, I can explain what operation the child might have thought the person that one needs to use. So the A is subtraction, B is addition, C is the correct answer, if your star means multiplication, and 32 is just a combining of the digits.
Correct. Can you see that? This is a very simple example. Can you see the cognitive process and the mathematical knowledge and skills that requires you to do that? But more important, can you see the implications of every single one of that item? It costs money to do that. It costs time to do hundreds of stuff. So the important point is, if you're a teacher, I don't need Anil and Jeanette to do analysis for you. I don't need fancy software to do it. I can look at that, I can see Jeanette got A. This is most now. It's an indication. It's not the definite answer. Maybe let me help Jeanette so-and-so. Let me help Nikki because she chose D. She probably forgot to interpret the sign. Or I, as a teacher, needed to make the sign more explicit. Does it make sense? That's diagnostic. One and two is, yes, it gives you information right and wrong, but it's not diagnostic. Do we get it, people? Really, really important. And I'm saying this because, as I'll show you later, so the point here is it's costly, especially if you like, and one, and secondly, it allows direct interpretation by teachers on their own. Okay, so, hey, tell me how much time I got, because I got a lot of slides and I can skip a lot as well. If you notice, I have a, did you guys notice my system of which sides to talk on and which sides to skip? I thought you were observable, smart, mathematical people who pick up every single full stop and dot. Just check the system. Somebody can tell me. Yeah? 5 minutes. Oh, shoot. Okay, so what's an overview of the system? Basically, this is an interpretation of the teaching learning process in the class. Intro lesson, activities, learners, etc., etc. Has to be underlined by support, etc. And then here's a whole lot of other aspects. Let me just show you very quickly. Summative assessments will fall here before the end of the activity, and I'm arguing diagnostic assessments fall in this process, and these two are very, very different, and to make the link, the formative assessments will come into this process, and I'm not going to focus on that, but just give you an idea of where it is. Okay. So, practical implications, let me skip that, let me give you some examples. So I'm going to give you some examples that we've used, of I've used in my class, and we've used in our intervention workshops with teachers. So reporting options. This is what our policy says, right? Am I right? You don't know? Or unless, I mean, I know I was away the last 2 weeks, so it must have changed. You don't know what this is. Okay, so it argues for this, and it's clear, people. This is not useful for diagnostic assessment purposes. And I can relate an example that I had a teacher with the teacher on my son's results, but let's not leave that. Okay, so what are the reporting options? There's various options. For the systems level, this is useful. Okay, how many learners at in red, yellow, green, etc. The Western Cape type of data, very useful for systems data. Again, teacher report we give to our teachers who participate for the classrooms. Very useful for the classroom level. Item map, again, item map very useful for learners. Why? So if you were to choose an item where learners had the most problem with, which one will you choose within less than 30 seconds? Number? Now you can shout. 15. Why? It tells you that, right? It's most red is 15, and if you want to choose which learner, you can see that, so that's quite individual, right? But for intervention purposes, not useful. Because it doesn't tell you what the issue was. Remember the first item? Did I subtract when I should have added? Did I multiply when I should have divided? Okay. This is smart. I met a teacher who did this. I was so impressed with her, and I would have hired her if I had the position. She took down her results for the few years, in the grades. And she basically said, which sections did the school do poorly on in grade 3, 4, 5, and 6? And look at that, what she found. In every grade, my school has a problem on ordering fractions. Can you see the purple? Again, useful for the school, but for individual? No. So, then the other issue is very useful at the systems level for equity. And I'm arguing our debates, our targets must be those learners in the red and purple in the bottom. We need to get them out of there. This must be on our NDP. This must be in the minister's agreement. Unfortunately, guess what? It's not there. Yeah. That's a different debate. So let's quickly just say, how would you then do it? What would be useful for learners? Ideally, we'd like to release these items for the children, for the parents, for teachers to use, to see. Practically, we can't do that. So what would be then an alternative? An alternative is we use performance levels, where we say, Nikki, this is where you're functioning at, and this is what you know. You can, I don't know, you can express decimal. Okay, see, I don't even understand the math here, but... Yeah, okay, that's it. So you can, this is what you know, Nikki. This is what you need to improve on. Now Nikki knows, and now a teacher knows how you can do that. Very different from... And then you can obviously... Also, it gives an indication of, at the teacher level, who's high risk, who's unlikely to succeed, what your intervention implications are, etc. And I'm going to go over this very fast. So, in our training program on teachers, for teachers on how to use formative assessment, we started this, we give them reports. These are the strategies you need to learn. You started off, this is how you started off at the beginning of the program. After our intervention, you need to make sure that you're going to improve because you're having challenges in feedback and you're having challenges in the section one. Can you see that? I know exactly where I'm at. I know where to focus on. And as program facilitators, we know what else to do. But what do I do in my class? So again, this is useful for the class level, not for individuals. Useful for me, but this is what I give my students. Every student at the beginning of the year would get to say, in section one, this is where you're at performance level 1, 2, 3. Section 2, section 3, section 4, etc., etc. And then I give them detailed explanations of what each performance level means in terms of your classroom knowledge, in terms of your interventions, and more important, the content knowledge. So performance levels, you know the purpose of assessment. Sorry, it's an assessment course that we give. You know the components, you know the primary uses, etc., etc. So students know exactly what they know, what they need to know, etc. And this is the rest of the slide. Let me then... There's this whole issue of diagnostic assessment testlets. When you see the PowerPoint, and this is to argue you can use this before every section that you work with. This is our really easy to use, wonderful Excel sheets that we give our students that they can use when they go out to teach. We did it ourselves, and I acknowledge, admit it must be professionalized, but here's the beauty part of it. You categorize each of your learners in each category, and so when you intervene as a teacher, you've got four groups to work on, and every group you know what is the strength, what is the weaknesses. Can you see that? So that's where your group work comes, and it's the evidence base. Let me then just end off with the issue of COVID. I'll be done in 2 minutes. So we did a study at TUT, again, if there's donors here, we did it with our own money, Jeanette and I with our own time, so own cost, I'm just saying. It was verified, the assessment knowledge and skills of teachers across no fee and fee schools was equally poor. We had evidence of that in previous studies, it was verified, but here's the stuff, here's is really critical. We need to take, and Kim's points have to come in here. There's new and different experiences which have the potential of establishing conducive environments for transformation in teachers' pedagogical practices. Let me be clear, assessment is a pedagogy. It's not absent of it. Especially the knowledge and skills, and more important, and we can talk about this, we worked on a couple of papers Jeanette and I wrote, patterns of engagement reflect potential to challenge current performative cultures and practices that foreground improvements in learning, improvements in teaching over curriculum coverage and test scores. And I think that's very important. And I got the evidence to show that in terms of what the evidence is, but here's the challenge I started off with. If we don't take advantage of the challenges and initiatives like this, it's important. What DBE is currently doing, the openness of DBE and the new stuff DBE is trying is fantastic, and and Kim, that point you made now is so important. Are we as NGOs, as scholars, researchers, practitioners, providing adequate alternatives and options for DBE to work on and select and say, yes, you've been working on that, we can work with you, we can do this. And DBE needs to come to the party to say, let's do that. And this is the evidence of all those findings. But look at this. The new school reform measures, and I'll end with this slide. The revised assessment guidelines, overwhelming majority of teachers, 73% said, it helped to improve my teaching. And that's unprecedented in our system. Let me stop there. Thanks. So, as a formative assessment activity, this is for you to do. If you're not going to ask a question, I'm not going to collect it. Usually I would collect it. I'll stand out there at the door and ask you to hand it in, but I'm not going to do that. Please do this. Again, it's a cognitive development trick, activity, and use it in your classrooms. But yeah, I'll stop there.
Thanks very much, Anil. I love listening to Anil speak, and I think it was a good to end on you because I don't think anybody was going to snooze through your presentation. Okay. Are there any questions for Anil before we just close and pull things together for the day? Shahida?
Thank you for the entertaining talk. But the one thing that I found your advice for teachers and the focus on diagnostic assessment very useful. I don't have questions, I just have two comments. The one is, and I'm hoping the people in the DBE and other provincial departments are listening, is that we spend a huge amount of time on assessments, but learners are actually not getting to see their scripts. I have first-hand experience of my niece, who I tutor, and the struggle to get her scripts from schools. And so there is an emphasis on teachers to keep the scripts as evidence of assessment, but learners are not actually getting, and parents are not getting access to those scripts. So that's the first point I want to make. The second point I wanted to make, and that is, while we can, what Anil has shown us is extremely useful, we also have to bear in mind that there are numerous ways in which a student can get an answer correct. So when Kim was pointing to earlier, that we have to listen to the logic of the teacher, we also have to listen to the logic of the learner. Because if you take that problem 82 minus 23, the problem Kim had on the board, and the student is working out that problem by drawing discs, when in fact, and gets the answer correct, what does it help the child or the parent that the student is getting the answer correct but not moving on to more efficient strategies? Even more sinister is that someone can get an answer correct using something that's completely not mathematical, but get the answer correct. So that is just two points that I want to make about this issue.
Thank you. I see there's another comment or question at the back. Okay, Kim, go first and then we'll
Thanks, Anil. And I'm particularly interested in diagnostic and formative assessment. The one thing kind of that I would want to share with all of us as a community is I think the piece of the equation that maybe we haven't invested enough thinking and time in is we all know that most of our teachers teach to the whole class. And I think some of us still think that differentiating our teaching to teach strategically in groups, I'm not talking about putting people in groups, strategically in groups, is a relatively small step that can be done through training. But I think the more we've seen from our own experience, and if you study low-income nations outside of South Africa, you see that it's very common that large classrooms and poorly resourced classrooms have a very hard time shifting from whole class to more differentiated. And in order to take advantage of a diagnostic, you have to have some ability to work with different groups differently. And I think that that whole research agenda of how do you slowly scaffold baby steps of differentiation rather than hoy suggestions and say all of a sudden we're working strategically in groups in classrooms that have not been set up for group work is a big research question facing the sector.
Thanks, Kim. I think we'll take one more comment from the back or question, and I see some people are needing to leave now, so we'll wrap it up after this comment. Okay, thank you.
Right. Thank you so much for your presentation. I'll keep it short. Could we go back to the last slide? Oh, maybe the one before that? Yeah, that one. This looks really fascinating. Just in terms of this change to the trimmed ATPs, this logically makes sense to me, but was, I guess, one, where is this from? So where is this data coming from? And two, has there been any more work to look at what was it really that helped to improve the teacher's teaching through these revised ATPs? What were the mechanisms there?
Yeah. Okay, look, there's lots of additional work that we did. The data is a survey that we sent out. It's not representative. Let me just be clear on that. As I said, funders note, we did it on our own with our own money. We might need more money for a bigger study. But yes, we did a lot of work. So for example, look at working in PLCs. It really helped. The allowing, you know, the new guidelines allow teachers, the whole issue of agency, to decide what to focus on and what the teachers need. Let me give you one example of what one school did from my hometown, Benoni. In Davyton, they had a rotational system. But instead of saying 1 week, Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, you, and then next week, you come Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, they said everybody alternate Monday, Wednesday, Tuesday, Thursday. And Fridays, they identified those learners that needed help over the 2 days and called them in on Fridays. Now, that was phenomenal. It's a quintile one school. Phenomenal. The teachers they chose. The trim curriculum for the first time, teachers in those large classes or in the schools who were not confident said, I feel confident. I'm able to do it. Of course, there were other challenges as well, but that's some of the issues we found from other parts of the qualitative stuff.
Okay. Thanks, Anil.
Pleasure.
So to wrap up, all I want to say is I think I really loved Nikki's slide with the big ship and the little yachts floating around. And I think as a collective here today, and we represent so many different organizations, institutions, individuals, teachers, students, researchers, community workers. And I think all of us together are trying to contribute to the bigger picture. And I think that, I'm not sure if there are DBE present, people still present now, but I think their presence here earlier is good. Their provincial people here, we're trying to work across all of the levels. And I think what people have been saying is we need to talk to each other and we need to listen to each other and that it goes both ways. So thank you for sharing with us today. Thank you for being together. At Bala Wande, one of our key goals has been to bring people together, to work collaboratively towards the solution of the problem of maths, the learner outcomes not being as good as they should be, not being where we'd like them to be. And knowing, I think, the important message is, and so many people say it, but it never seems to be well understood, that there is not one silver bullet. So although we are aiming to produce something, we do not think it will be the only solution for South Africa. And all of the colleagues working together are producing different things which could be used in different contexts. And I really think we need to hold on to that. where we can come together to make something stronger and something better, that will be great. But where we can show the value of different things in different places for different people, and if that could be accepted as part of our country's approach, not one silver bullet, not one DBE book the same for everyone, couldn't we do different things for different people and have different possibilities available? And then we could see where that takes us. Thanks very, very much. Travel home safely, and we hope to see you again at our next event like this one. Thank you.